All right, and welcome back. I hope you guys are doing well. It's a brand new day and a brand new lecture for some brand new marks in your exams. I'll tell you what's in store. This subject and this chapter is for CA Inter, return of income. As return of income is something that is needed. It's the last chapter and it's not the most important. It's a little theoretical, but this video will help you completely understand it by hearted. We're also looking at the entire module, some sums from it. So that all you need to do is watch this video every time you want to revise this chapter called Return of Income. Here we go, guys. CA Inter, Return of Income. Here we go. Let's first understand where is Return of Income needed. Guys, Return of Income, first, you will, of course, file your legal status. Then you will file your residential status. Then you will add all the five heads of income which you've learned. Then you will do clubbing because C first, and then you will do set off. Then you will come to something which is called gross total income. From that, you will minus your deductions and you will come to total income. Then you will compute your rates of tax. We've done all of these chapters. And then finally, you will pay them using TDS, TCS, and advanced tax. Now, while all this happens in the previous year, you have to at least tell the government how the year has been for you. And you need to file your return of income and pay whatever balance tax that is after TCS, TDS, advance tax, whatever balance tax or interest and you need to pay it to the government. So this is return of income chapter. Guys, all this is happening in the previous year. So your previous year from an examination perspective, the return of income I'm putting as a heading. Your previous year is 2021. So you will earn income, you will pay TDS, TCS, advance tax in this year, but your return filing requirements happen in the assessment year. So assessment year for you guys is 21-22. And then this year is what all the return formalities are. Example, you will file your return either yourself or through a CA or through someone we will see in this chapter who will help you to file your returns. You'll file your returns. If you file them late, what happens? If you file them early, what happens? What if you can? If you've forgotten to do something, can you revise it, guys? Can you revise your return? All these and more we will study in this chapter. First, let's understand the chapter through this document here, and then we'll look at the module and solve a couple of questions as well. Guys, the sections, they start with section 139.1. And 139.1 says that who needs to file the return of income. Guys, you are students. Maybe you don't file a return of income. I am a professional. I file my return. So who should file? Who shouldn't file? We will see in 139. So 139.1 says that for two people, it's compulsory to file their incomes. So for companies and for firms. There's a shortcut here. For companies and for firms, it's compulsory to file their return of income. Compulsory to file. C and F, so companies and firms. That's how you'll remember. It's compulsory to file. Who is it compulsory to file? For companies and firms. So if you have a company, private limited company, unlisted company, public limited company, or you have a partnership firm or an LLP, is then compulsory. Whether you earn money or you don't earn money, whether you have income or whether you have losses, every year compulsory you have to file your return of income. What about the others? Now, others means individuals, HUFs, AOP, BOI, AJP, all others come in the others. The others will need to file their return if they are gross total income. Guys, here we are. Gross total income plus your 54 exemptions. If you remember the 54 exemptions in chapter capital gain, if this is more than your basic exemption limit, that means you have earned some income which is more than your basic exemption limit. The government wants to know who you are. I repeat, not your total income. We generally use total income, but this one is on gross total income. Your gross total income plus your 54E, that should be more than the base exemption limit only then. So let's say you're an individual and you just took up a CA job and in your CA job, you earn 5 lakh rupees, not your total income, guys. Look at the gross total income. And if you have any capital gain exemptions, add that. And if that is more than base exemption limit, which is 2.5 lakh, 3 lakh, 5 lakh, for AOP, BOI, HUF, etc., higher base exemption limit also, then that case you will have to file your return. All right. So it's either companies or firms where compulsory or others where you're supposed to file it only if you have income more than basic exemption. But there's another shortcut. I'm very excited to give you the shortcut. But if you have coffee, guys, do you enjoy coffee? Do you have coffee? And the spelling is different. If you have coffee, then you need to compulsorily file your return even if your income is low. Guys, let's say you have zero income, then do you need to file your return? No. But if you have zero income, but you have coffee, then you'll have to file your return. This is for the others, guys. This is an exception for the others. In others, if you have coffee, you'll have to file your return. What is coffee? C is current account. If in your current account, you have deposited and not withdrawn, guys. Withdrawn is in TDS, section 194N notes, if you remember. But this one is if in your current account you have deposited money more than 1 crore in the year, then we want to know who you are. Please file your return. If you have traveled to foreign country and if you have incurred foreign on foreign any travel, you have incurred more than 2 lakh rupees. Travel basically means your flight tickets, your stay, everything includes everything. If you spend more than 2 lakhs, not just for yourself, but any other person you paid for, even in that case, the government wants to know who you are. So they want to get your return of income. And if you have electricity expenses more than 1 lakh rupees, yes, you heard it right, guys. Electricity expenses more than 1 lakh rupees in the year, then you need to file your return of income compulsory. You cannot say, I don't have any incomes or this is no excuses. You'll have to file your return. And what is O? O, I've kept it for last, guys. O is only applicable to residents and ordinary residents. It is not applicable to R and OR. It is not applicable to NR. It is only applicable to R, OR. If you're a resident and ordinary resident, that means you're ordinary in India. And if you have any foreign asset, or if you have any foreign bank account, or if you're a beneficiary of any foreign interest or foreign asset, that means, let's say you have a house in London, or you have a bank account in the US, or if you have shares abroad, or if you're a partner in a partnership firm abroad, then in all these cases, including a partnership firm, guys, if you're a partner, in all these cases, there is outside India. So always outside India. If outside India, you have any asset, then government wants to know who you are, asset or a bank account or financial interest also. The government wants to know who you are, but this is only applicable for ROR. So if you're enjoying your coffee, then please understand that with coffee, you'll have to compulsorily file your return of income. This is an exception to others. That is section 139.1, guys. Section 139.1 tells you to file your return. Now, section 139.2 is not important. It's not even there. Section 139.3 is the same return, but if you have a loss, then that loss return of income is the section is different. Section 139.3. Is there a different form for it? Or do you have to wear different clothes to file that form? No, nothing different, guys. 139.3 is the same thing, except it's called return of income. And why is it so important that if you have a loss, you should file your return on time? Because, guys, if you have a loss and you file your return late, you will not be allowed to be carried forward for that loss. Example, in the year 2021, I have a loss, let's say, of 5 lakhs. And in the year 1920, I had a loss of 3 lakhs, which was carried forward to this year. So this is carried forward loss of 3 lakhs, and this 5 lakhs is fresh loss. This year, I filed my return of income on time. Everything was good. My CA was good. He filed in time. But this year, something happened and my return of income got filed late. Then this year's loss, which is 5 lakh, will not be allowed to be carried forward. What about the 3 lakh? 3 lakh is being carried forward. So that can be carried forward ahead. No problem with that. Because guys, so how do you remember this? Do you remember this? The year you go wrong, that year's loss cannot be carried forward. So that is loss return of income. And it has two exceptions. One is unabsorbed depreciation, because they want to encourage you to have depreciation. Unabsorbed depreciation is allowed to be carried forward. And any loss from house property, that you can carry forward even if you file your return of income late. That is section 139.3. That is loss return, section 139.3. Loss, is it important to file your return? Yes, not just that, you have to file it in time. Otherwise, you will not be able to carry forward that loss. You understood it. And except two exceptions, unabsorbed depreciation and loss from house property. Next, guys, you know, we are always running late in to do many things in life. So return of income also could be filed late. So if you file it late, it's called a belated return under section 139.4. This is called a belated return. Belated, you know, guys, belated happy birthday. So belated, you know what it is late. And this return is called belated return. Can you file it? Yes. How late can you file it? Guys, as I told you, you can do everything in the assessment year. So how late can you file it? Till the last day of this assessment year. So basically till 31st March 2022, in your case, you can file it till March 31st, 2022. That is how late you can file it. Procrastination, everyone procrastinates. So if you procrastinate, you can file your belated return, but by the end of the assessment year, not after that. But guys, belated return, that means filing a return late, is not going to be something that the government likes. So because otherwise everyone will file their return late. So hence the government has said that if you file your return late, loss will not be allowed to be carried forward, that you already know, except two losses, unabsorbed depreciation and loss from house property. So I'm just writing loss cannot be carried forward. Next, whatever tax that you have to pay, my bad, whatever tax that you have to pay. So let's say after TDS, after TCS, after advance tax, you have to pay, let's say 25,000 rupee tax on that there will be interest under section 234A. Under section 234A, you will have to pay interest at the rate of 1%. So let's say your return was supposed to be filed by a particular day, and if you file it late from that particular day, that means up till that date, no problem. But after that day, example, you were supposed to file your return by 31st July, but you filed it, let's say, in October. So August, September, October, 3 months, you filed it late. So for those 3 months, you'll have to pay interest at the rate of 1% per month or part of the month. Even part of the month is the entire 1%. That is the second repercussion. So you'll have to, first, loss will not be allowed to be carried forward. Second, you'll have to pay interest under section 234A. And the last, which is a very dangerous repercussion, which is a late fee. Under section 234F, F is fee. So remember, late fee, or F is a fine. You have two shortcuts, either a fee or late fine, you can think of. That is 234F. You'll have to pay a fine. You are late, so you'll have to pay a fine. How much is the fine, guys? It's 5,000 rupees up to 31st December. If you're so late, then 5,000. But if you're late even after 31st December, late, let's say you file it in Jan, Feb or March, because after March, you cannot file anyways. So in Jan, Feb or March, you file. Then after 31st December, guys, you'll have to pay 10,000 rupee fine. This is one threat where we CAs give to our clients so that they file their return on time. They give us the details and we can file it on time. But guys, this is a lot of money. Imagine if you have 5-7 members in the family, they'll have to pay so much of fine. And as the government says, it is restricted to only rupees 1,000 if your total income is up to 5 lakhs. That means if you're not earning much. If your total income is up to 5 lakh, that means you're not earning too much, then we don't want to put such heavy fines or such heavy fees. So only 1,000 rupees. So three repercussions of belated return. 139.4 says belated return, and that there are three repercussions. Guys, you can make a note of this also. 139.4, belated return. That means filing your return late. How late? During the anytime during the assessment year. Anytime till the assessment year. Anytime is belated. Of course, after the due date. And three things happen. Loss cannot be carried forward. 234A interest. When will the interest be on? How much? Whatever tax you need to pay on that interest. And from the day you're supposed to file, after that, because till you're supposed to file, why will they charge you interest? After that, they're charging you interest. And 234F is a fine of 5,000 or 10,000. Now that we know you should not file it late, then by when should you file it? So what is the due date? That is we're looking for. What is the due date? Guys, the due dates, there are three due dates, but only two are important at CA inter-level. There are three due dates. First, the government says that 31st July is the due date. See how the government thinks. The year ends in March, so April, May, June, July, 4 months you have. So by 31st July, you should file your return. We are okay with it. But then some people did not like this. They said that we need more time because we are subject to audits. Who are these people? Companies said that we are supposed to be audited under the company's law. Some firms said that we are supposed to be audited because we are crossing the threshold under 44AB. So audit under any law, whether Income Tax Act or any other act, if you're supposed to be audited, that means if a CA is supposed to come and check your books and certify them, etc., then you get a slightly longer due date, that is 31st October. This is your due date for return of income. 31st July for everyone, 31st October for those people who have to file the return of income. And the last due date, which is not important for you because at CA final level, is those people who have international transactions. That means you're buying, you're in India, you're Pfizer, you're buying it from Pfizer, US, you're buying some goods, you're buying some vaccines, etc. So these are international transactions for which it is 30th November. So there are three due dates, guys, but this one is more at CA final level. Actually, not more, it's entirely at CA final level. So for CA Inter, you have this one and this one. This one is not for CA Inter. Very simple to understand. For most people, it's 31st July. But for those people who are subject to audit under any law, 44AB or any other law, then it's 31st October. And international transaction, 30th November. Now, although the return filing has to be done by 31st October, the audit report has to be given 1 month in advance. This is a recent change. Earlier, they could have both filed together. But here, return filing is 31st October, but audit report due date is 30th September. So the government wants the CAs to work slightly faster and at least give the audit report by 30th September. The return can be filed by 31st October. There are two different things, guys. Audit report has to be 1 month in advance, and your return of income can be by 31st October. Now I have a question. I'm a partner in a partnership firm. Let's say the surgeon only, guys. He's a partner in a partnership firm called Syringe & Co., which we all know. Now Syringe & Co. is supposed to be under audit. So its deadline is 31st October. Why audit? Because maybe it's crossed a threshold of 1 crore, etc., 5 crores. So it's under audit. Now, till we don't finalize this, we cannot finalize the surgeon's return. Why? Because guys, the surgeon has to get some income, salary, remuneration, interest, etc. And that, as you know, is under section 40B5 and 40B4 limits. And those limits for a partnership firm, only once their limits, you will set their limits, whatever is their deduction will be your income. So that means, guys, if you're a partner in a partnership firm and the partnership firm is supposed to be audited, then even you get an extended due date. Even you get an extended due date. So you can write that point here. Partner of a partnership firm, which is supposed to be audited. Then even a partner comes on 31st October. Why? Because until the partnership firm's details are not finalized, how do you know how much you take in your income? And hence you will also get a due date of 31st October. So these are the three due dates on the screen. And if you file it on time, congratulations, good job. But if you file it late, you know, three repercussions, which we've just seen above. Perfect. Let's go to the next section, guys. The next section is section 139.5. Section 139.5, it's said that, guys, once you file your return, people generally forget things. Like, you know, remember 80GG, that ghar-ghar deduction, or 80TTA, that interest deduction. Sometimes people forget, or so, let's say you forgot some income, so you want to revise it. Can you revise your return? Section 139.5 says, yes, you can revise your return of income. It can be revised any number of times. There is no fee, guys, to revise it. Thankfully, there is no fee to revise it. It can be revised any number of times. Of course, during the assessment year, not after the assessment year. Everything has to finish off in the assessment year. You want to file it late? You can file it late. Even late returns can be revised. So you can file it late and then also revise it. Early returns can also be filed. Every return can be revised, guys. Every return. Because it's obvious, guys. It's human to make mistakes. So if you make a mistake, can you revise it? Yes, you can. You can revise it anytime during the assessment year. No questions asked, no fee taken. That is 139.5. Next. So just recapping, while we're scrolling down, 139.1 says who should file the return. And that coffee, remember? Current account more than 1 crore, etc. 139.3 says loss return. 139.4 said you can file it late, but three repercussions, one interest, one fee. And what are the due date? 31st July, 31st October, and 30th November. This is something that you keep in mind. And can you revise it? Yes, as many number of times you want. No fee, nothing, no questions asked. Even late returns can be revised. Next, we go to 139.6, which is a very useless section. Because 139.6 says that if you're filing your return, you should give some documents, you should give some details. Guys, details are very obvious. How much was your turnover? What were your different incomes? What were your deductions? What is your tax? All these details you need to give. And 139.6A says that if you're in PGBP, then you need to give some more details like your turnover of your business, plus your expenses in your business, plus any deductions, plus any other details of your business like place of business, if it's a partnership firm, who are the partners, etc. All these details, but of course, this is all electronic, guys. So you'll need to fill in all these details. And of course, if you're under audit, then you need to give the audit details as well. That is section 139.6 and 6A, not really important. 6 only tells you what details to be given in other places. And 6A says in business, what details you need to give. Next, something that is really important is 139.9, which is the next section. So you can write 139.9 and you can write defective return. Important because first we should know when is a return defective. Guys, there can be many ways when a return is defective. I'll give you some of the ways. When you're supposed to give some details and you have not given it. When it's supposed to be signed by the proper person and it's not signed by it. Of course, sign means even digital signature. When you have not done something, when you have not given some information or details, again, the same thing. So your return can be defective. And if your return is defective, it could be many reasons, guys. it could be not giving some details, it could not giving some information, not signing it right, etc. Then in that case, you will get an intimation. Intimation, of course, is not, the officer will not come to your house. There'll be an email coming back to you saying that this is defective and you need to correct the defect. And for that, you get 15 days to correct the defect. From the day they intimate you, they give you 15 days. Of course, that can be extended if you request them that, listen, I'm not well or something happened, genuine cause. It can also be extended. So this is defective return, section 139.9. It can be defective, yes. It can be corrected, of course, yes. But what if you don't correct it? Then they will assume that you never filed your return. So if you file your return on time, but a defect comes in and you don't correct a defect, can you say I will carry forward my loss? No, because it's assumed that you have not filed your return. But guys, one thing you have to note here, that's an exception almost, that when you file your return of income, but you don't pay tax along with it, you don't have money, you filed your return, but you've not paid tax, or there's some interest which you've not paid, tax, interest, or any other amount that you're supposed to pay, you've not paid, that will not render it defective. As long as you file your return, even if you've not paid the tax, interest, etc., that will not be defective. So when the exam comes that you filed your return, but you've not paid the tax, can it be a defective return under 139.9? No, it cannot be a defective return. But in GST, guys, same thing in GST. If you file your return without paying the tax, it is not a valid return. So there are different things. GST, they want the money. Here, even if you don't give the money, because so much has already been given in advance tax, CDS, TCS, they're okay with it. So hence they say that this is not a defective return. Now guys, everything has to be verified, right? So if you're filing your return, don't you think you need to verify it? Yes, you need to verify it. You need to get it signed. But of course, now all returns are electronic and hence the signature also electronic. Who will sign? Very, very logical section. Section 140 talks about verification. Who will verify the return? That is what section 140 says. Very, very logical. First, if you're an individual, who will verify it? Of course, you yourself will verify it. If you're not available, let's say you're a wanderlust guy, you keep traveling across the world, then anyone who is authorized, of course, the power of attorney, that is the authority, has to be also uploaded along with the return. If you're someone who's not smart, guys, who's of unsound mind, then the person who's your guardian has to sign. So these are the people in case of an individual. Next comes HUF. Of course, you always know HUF, guys, who's the main guy, the karta has to sign. But if the karta is not there, any adult member. Adult member basically means any person who's more than 18 can sign it. Of the HUF, of course, guys, not some random person. And if that person is also not there, then authorized persons can sign it. But of course, the authority also has to be uploaded. So karta, or then any adult member, not male member, any adult member. Next comes, guys, partnership form. So any partner, no, first managing partner. If he is not there, then any authorized person or any other partner can sign. Very simple, very logical. First the main guy, if not the main guy, then the others can also sign. Same thing in LLP also, guys. But here it's not called managing partner, it's called designated partner. The word changes, but again the main partner has to sign. Otherwise the same thing, that is any authorized person or any other partner can sign. In case of a company, be it a limited company or a private company or a one person company, whatever it is, first the managing director has to sign it. Or authorized person or any other director can sign it. But of course, the first preference is for managing director. If he is not there, then authorized person. And wherever there is authorized person, you need to upload the authority or any other director. But guys, a company which is under liquidation, like Kingfisher, so a liquidator has to sign it. A company which has gone into insolvency under an Insolvency Act, guys. Insolvency. Again, almost like liquidation, but now we have a separate act for it. And there is an insolvency professional, IP he's called, insolvency professional. He has to sign it. And in case it's a company where the board has been taken over by the government, example, Yes Bank, guys, Yes Bank, they remove the board and replaced by the government, then whoever is the designated officer, he will sign it. I'll repeat, guys, for a company, the main guy has to sign it, otherwise any other director. If it's a company in liquidation, the liquidator has to sign it. If it's a company in insolvency, then the insolvency professional has to sign it. And if it's a company where the government has taken over it, then the designated officer has to sign it. But some signature is required. For a political party, yes, guys, even political parties need to file their returns. There is someone called the CEO of a political party. He has to sign it. And for any other person, the main guy, if any other person, they ask you also, guys, the main guy, if it's for a trustee, then if it's a trust, then trustee has to sign. So same way, any other person also, the main person has to sign. This is called verification of return. Perfect. Let's move ahead, guys. So we're done with this. You want to file your return. You go to a CA. The CA says, I'll charge you 5,000 rupees. You say, it's too much. He says, no, these are my charges. So hence, the government, you complain to the government that you should have some boys who helped me file my return. And hence, the government heard you. And they created a section called 139B, Tax Return Preparers. Tax Return Preparers. They are preparing your return. They are helping you file your return. I call them those boys who wear a t-shirt called TRP. And they are Tax Return Preparers. They help you file the return. Now, who can go to such tax return preparers? Any person can go as long as they're not subject to any audit. So if you're subject to audit, sorry, you cannot go to them. And who can be, so this is the person who's filing it. And who can become TRPs? Any of you who has a graduate from commerce, banking background can become a TRP, but except these people cannot be TRPs. A CA cannot be a TRP. Why? Because anyway, is a CA. A lawyer cannot be a TRP. A person who is a banker cannot be a TRP. And an employee of a small company, cannot be a TRP. Small company is a company which is not subject to any audit. So employee of a small company is not subject to, cannot be a TRP. So first, who can use the TRP? Anyone except the person who is required to be audited. Audited, that means you're big, so you cannot go to a TRP. And who can be a TRP tomorrow, guys? Of course, you are becoming CA, so you cannot be a TRP. A lawyer cannot be a TRP. Bankers cannot be a TRP. An employee of small companies cannot be TRP. Employees of big companies can be TRPs. These are TRPs. You can get your original return. And if you want to revise it also, you can use TRPs. But guys, you can revise it. One point you can write in your books that if you want to revise your return of income, there's a condition. What is the condition? The original return should also be using a TRP. So if you file original return by yourself, then revision cannot happen through TRP. So if you file original return by TRP, only then that or any other TRP can help you revise your return as well. Next. So just revising the sections till now. While we scroll down, we'll just revise the sections till now. Guys, section 139.1 tells you companies and firms compulsory to file, others coffee, remember, or income is greater than basic exemption limit, income, that is GTI plus 154. 139.3 is loss return. You know, loss return have to be filed on time. 139.4 is belated. You can file it late during the assessment year, but there are three repercussions which you know. 234A is interest when you file it late. 234F is fees when you file it late. 139.5, can you revise it? Yes, you can revise it as many times. Three dates, 31st July, 31st October, and 30th November. But remember, even if it's 31st October, the audit report has to be filed 1 month in advance. 139.6 and 6A were the details to be given while you file a return. Not important. 139.9, very important, defective return. But remember, not filing that and not paying the tax is not defective. 140 is basically the people who have to sign your return. And let's go to the next one. 139B is tax return preparer. Those boys which will help you file your returns, tax return preparers. The next one is the most simple one, 139A. You got to have your PAN number. That is the most basic condition to file your return. You have to have your PAN number. So if you don't have one, let's say you become a CA and you get a job and you don't have a PAN, then after the year ends by 31st May, at least you should apply for your PAN. Because it takes some few days to get your PAN. So hence by 31st May, you should apply for your PAN. Not just that, even the officer can allot you a PAN. If he feels you need a PAN, he can allot you a PAN. And when you get a PAN, guys, you have to quote it everywhere. When you buy a car, yes. When you buy a property, yes. When you buy shares, etc., yes. Mostly, car always, immovable property always. But for the others, when you're buying more than 50,000 rupees something, let's say you buy jewelry worth more than 50,000, or you buy something worth more than 50,000, then you need to quote your PAN number. And 139A, additional document that you require is Aadhaar. But Aadhaar, as you know, guys, although it's needed, it's not compulsory. You can use your PAN interchangeably. If you don't have Aadhaar, you can use your PAN, no problem with that. So 139A and 139AA, I'm just looking at any other section that we need to do. Perfect, perfect, perfect. Now, when you file your return, and of course, there is some tax that needs to be paid. Example, let's say you paid your TDS. Of course, deducted TDS, TCS has also been collected, advance tax you paid. After that, there was some TDS 234C. Remember the interest on the installments, there was some interest, let's say 5,000 rupees. Then 234B, remember after C comes B, and in B, actually B comes before, but in interest calculation after C, let's say there was an interest of 3,000 rupees on 234B. And under 234A, again, let's say you file your return late, so there is 1,000 interest. So total interest is 9,000 rupees. This you need to pay. Plus you're filing your return late. So under 234F, you have a fee of, let's say, 5,000 rupees. So that is 14,000 rupees. And plus your tax, guys, is 16,000 rupees. So basically, you need to pay 30,000 rupees. Tax 16, fee 5, and interest 9. This is how what you need to pay. Now, you don't have 30,000 rupees. You have only 20,000 rupees. So you pay 20. But guys, how will this 20 be adjusted? How will this 20 be adjusted? They will adjust it first against the fee. So the fee they will take, that is 5,000. Then they will adjust it against interest. Interest is 9,000, that is 14,000 over. And rest goes to tax, 6,000. So your tax is totally 16, but out of that only you paid 6, that will be assumed. And on the remaining, they will charge you interest. So guys, the government is very smart. Because if they adjust it against tax first, then you will not have to pay interest on the tax. So the government is very smart, and that's how the government keeps themselves fit. Guys, this is a shortcut, FIT. So first F fee, next I interest, and next T tax. That is the order. That is the order. Perfect. So FIT, fit, that is the order. Just 1 second. All right. So let's look at the last section, guys. Section 140A, which is called self-assessment tax. After you assess yourself, after the year is over, you will assess yourself. You will say that I have already paid TDS, TCS, advance tax, but I have to pay interest of this much, fee of this much, and tax of this much. So you will pay the tax, the self-assessment tax you will pay. With your return of income, before your return of income, around that time, you will fill up a challan and you will file yourself, or you will pay your self-assessment tax. But that tax will be adjusted in this manner called FIT, F-I-T, as you saw. If you pay entire 30,000, there is no problem only. But if you pay less, it will be first adjusted against the fee, then against the interest, and then against the tax, so that you will, they will calculate some tax, some interest on that balance tax. So that's how they keep themselves fit. Guys, that in a nutshell is this chapter. This chapter, the importance of this could be 2 marks to 4 marks now in your 60 marks of DT. It could be about 2 to 3 marks. I've seen exams where this chapter has not been questioned at all, but sometimes it might be questioned for 2 to 4 marks. So you could look at this video again and again whenever you want to revise. Also, please remember, here, the sections, the ones that I've discussed, are only important. When do you have to quote your PAN? If you by heart that entire list, that is not required. So I'm just revising the section 139.1. Entire chapter, let's revise, guys. 139.1 is when you need to file a return, compulsory to file. For the others, if their income, that is GTI above, plus the 54 exemption is more than the basic exemption limit. And remember, coffee, current accounts more than 1 crore. Outside India, if you have any assets, foreign expenses more than 2 lakhs for yourself and any other person also. And electricity expenses more than 1 lakh. 139.3 says loss return. Losses can be carried forward. No, sorry, cannot be carried forward if your return is late. If it's on time, no problem. So file it in time and carry it forward. Next, there are two exceptions which you know under 139.3. 139.4 is belated. Can you file it late? Yes, you know, but you know there are three repercussions. Loss, 234A interest, and 234F fine. 234A is the interest. The interest is on what amount? On the tax that you need to pay, or whatever amounts that you need to pay, on that amount there will be interest at the rate of what? 1%, and starting from when? After the day that you were supposed to file your return. 234F, is basically fee of 5,000 up to 30th December, 31st December. After 31st December, Jan, Feb and March is 10,000. But if your total income is only up to maximum 5 lakh, don't worry, only 1,005. What are the due dates? 31st July, who's supposed to be audited? No, who's not supposed to be audited. Who's supposed to be audited? 31st October, even a partner who's not supposed to be audited, but he's a part of a partnership firm which is supposed to be audited, he'll get 31st October. And last 30th November, not for y'all, but for international transactions. Remember, any audit, 31st October. No audit, 31st July. Then is 139.5 revised return. You can revise it as many number of times. Any return, even late return, can be revised. 139.6 and 139.6 are the details you need to give along with the return. 139.9 is a defective return. Defective can be corrected, but not corrected, then they will see that it's not a return at all. And guys, defective return has to be corrected within 15 days. That can be extended. But not paying your tax is not a defect. 140A is a return that you can pay late, this is self-assessment tax, first F, then I, and then T. 139A is basically your Aadhaar, so your PAN. 139A is your Aadhaar. In case you don't have a PAN, the officer can also allot you a PAN. And I forgot, 139B is tax return preparers, those people who help you. Audit guys cannot take tax return preparers, the others can take tax return preparers. Besides that, there are some sections like 139A or 139. Those where 1C or 1A, 139, 1C, I'll just tell you, are those people where the government can say that they are not supposed to file the return. 139, 1A is where the employer files your return in bulk for all the employees, like Infosys has lakhs of employees, all the returns are filed on time, but not really important. Hence, you can skip those, not really important. Now, over to the module, guys, just looking at the module and testing our knowledge. State with reasons whether you agree or disagree with the following statements. Return of income of LLP can be verified by any partner. Partly right, partly not right, because first by designated partner, if he's not there, then any other partner. Next, time limit for filing return of income under section 139.1 in case of Mr. A having total turnover of 160 lakhs, 100 lakhs received in cash for the year ended 31st March 2021, whether or not opting to presumptive income under 44AD is 31st October. They are saying for Mr. A, it's always 31st October. I don't agree. If he goes under presumptive taxation, guys, 44AD, then there is no audit. And if it's no audit, then 31st July. Because you don't require so much time. But if he does not go under 44AD, then he'll have to get audited because his turnover is more than 1 crore. And his cash payments are huge. So he'll have to get himself audited. And when he has to get himself audited, then 31st October. So this statement is not entirely true. Mr. Vineet submits his return of income consisting of income under the head salaries, income from house property and bank interest on 21st Jan 2022. Sorry, he filed it on 12th September. Is he filing it on time? Maybe, doesn't matter, doesn't look like, or maybe it's late also, doesn't matter. But in the same year, on 21st of Jan, he realized that he has not claimed reduction under 80TTA, which is very common, guys. Lots of people forget it. He's also forgotten it. He wants to revise his return. Can he do so? Yes, he can, because 139.5 allows you to revise it anytime till the assessment year you are in the assessment. Examine. Would your answer be different if they discovered the omission after the assessment year? Guys, even if it's 21st April, that is 21 days after the assessment year. Sorry, you cannot revise it. So revision is possible only during the assessment year. Let's look at the next question. Examine with reasons whether the following statements are true or false. The assessing officer has the power, inter alia, that means amongst other things, to allot the PAN to any person by whom no tax is payable. Yes, the assessing officer has that kind of power. Next, where the karta of an HUF is absent from India, karta is not there, the return of income can be verified by any male member of the family. No, not male, any adult member of the family. So this is false. And this one, explain the term return of loss. As per section 139.3, if you have any loss from any of the heads, then that's a return of loss. Can any loss be carried forward even if return of loss has not been filed as required? Even if you don't file or you file your return late, guys. Even if you file your return late or if you don't file your return, two losses can be carried forward. That is unabsorbed depreciation and loss from house property. These two losses can be carried forward whenever, wherever. Guys, this is the module. Direct from the module, we solved questions. This is the chapter. This is the chapter. I'm stopping the share. Again, repeating, guys, return of income is a theoretical chapter. Watch this video every time you want to revise this chapter. Remember the sections. Remember loss return. Remember those things like FIT, etc., which could come in an MCU question. At fees first, interest later, and then tax later. As return of income, entire thing happens in the assessment year. You can revise it as many number of times. You can File it late also, but late repercussions are three. You should know that. And with that, guys, we complete return of income. That was the last chapter. I hope you've done all the before chapters also. Revise them, re-revise them. All the best and see you guys really soon. All the best. Thank you.